Good evening, and welcome to Lewisburg United Methodist Church. We are so thankful that you're joining us today on live stream for our slightly delayed Sunday morning service.
We're glad that you're with us, and if you'd like to join us in the sanctuary, we are now open for worship. We have plenty of room to social distance, and of course, we all wear our mask while we attend, so we'd love for you to come beginning next Sunday at 10 a.m. for our live stream, but also in-person worship, so we hope you can join us. Let us open our hearts to the opening song. May we be reminded to stand on God's promises. Look forward to our student pastor Tyler Bland to share the word today, and it's one of Jesus's challenges to be on guard. Tyler's going to spend some time reminding us that it's important to stand on what is true. And so Mary Claire has put together for us the Apostles' Creed that I would like for you to say with me as you watch the words on the screen. Let your hearts respond to the Apostles' Creed through this musical response.
Join us for A Word for Children by Bev, with a song for children following.
Good morning. Today we're talking about what is truth and what is a lie. So I'm going to throw out some truths and some lies. If I'm telling the truth, I want you to give it a thumbs up with your family. If I am telling a lie, give your family a thumbs down. Are you ready? Soccer teams kick a ball. Thumbs up or thumbs down? The earth is shaped like a square. Our state is West Virginia. West Virginia can be found in Mexico. Now I'm gonna get a little trickier. Those were pretty easy. But there's some things that people will tell you in this life that just aren't true. So I want you to tell us whether these are true or false. You are only good if you make straight A's. You should always win and never lose. When someone says something mean to you, you should believe them. How about this one? If your mom asks you to help clean up, it's okay to ignore her. You know, today in worship, Tyler is going to remind us that God speaks to us through the Bible and through our faith friends, and that God always speaks truth. We have to learn to listen to God and ignore the things that this world might say. Amen.
Join us for a song of praise by Kirsten and Lara.
Thank you.
Donna Rehm shares the Word of God, may your hearts be challenged by Jesus to be on guard.
The scripture this morning comes from the book of Mark, chapter 13, verses 5 to 11. I'll be reading from the New International Version. Jesus said to them, "Watch out that no one deceives you. Many will come in my name, claiming I am he, and will deceive many. When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places and famines. These are the beginning of birth pains. You must be on your guard. You will be handed over to the local councils and flogged in the synagogues. On account of me, you will stand before governors and kings as witnesses to them. And the gospel must first be preached to all nations. Whenever you are arrested and brought to trial, do not worry beforehand about what to say. Just say whatever is given you at the time, for it is not you speaking, but the Holy Spirit." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
In 2004, a young woman in Durham, North Carolina, made some alarming allegations against three men's lacrosse players at Duke University. It would go on to be headline news for months. Eventually, one of the lacrosse players appeared in front of the media and said that, "You have been fed some fantastic lies." As the case went to court, it was determined that these allegations were bogus, having no truth to them. But the damage had been done. These young men had their reputations scarred and their immediate futures altered. Maybe not to that extreme, but somehow, some way, we have all been told some fantastic lies. Recently at Huddle, we began a new series called "The Bible Doesn't Say That," where we address some popular sayings that we say that we believe to be the gospel, but you will never find them in Scripture. Statements like "God helps those who help themselves," like "God will never give you more than you can handle," or that "everything happens for a reason." Mary Claire has put together this video of a few of our youth group students sharing some other lies they believed when they were younger.
The lie I believed as a kid was, if you ate too much chocolate, you died.
When I was younger, I believed that if you ate too much of something, you would turn into it.
A lie that I believed when I was younger was that if you look at old pictures back in the days that were in black and white, I thought that back then was black and white and there was no color.
When I was younger, my parents told me that if I crossed my eyes, they would stay there forever.
John Quincy Adams once said, "Whoever tells the best story wins." Haven't we discovered that to be true in our world? May not always listen to the individuals who tell us the truth, but those that will tell us the best stories, the ones that will grab our attention. Jesus even acknowledged this by saying, "Stay on guard, be careful of false teachers, for they are deceiving, and they will lead many astray." Growing up, I always pictured false teachers as the ones that you would see on TV that would always say statements like, "God desires for you to be healthy and wealthy all the days of your life." But there are other false teachers as well. There's, like the group I just mentioned, there's a group that's soft, and we would commonly refer to them as people who sugarcoat the gospel. But on the other side of the aisle, you also have a group that can be too hard. And we'll just focus on the rules. They are almost like the modern-day Pharisees, the people that Jesus wouldn't exactly see eye to eye with. A couple years ago, I served as a camp counselor for 1 week. And we had a student that attended this camp that just seemed out of place. He wouldn't say much unless it was an inappropriate comment. And that week, the main theme was telling middle school students about how God is pursuing them and desires to be in a relationship with you and with me. And he pulled me and a few other counselors to the side one evening, and he said, "That message isn't for me. God doesn't want to be in a relationship with me. God is still upset with me." Now that warrants a little bit of an explanation. So he would go on to tell us this long story of how a couple years prior, his father had passed away due to an overdose. And after his father's passing, a few religious people stopped by the house and blamed the death on the family. They would say that the family was guilty of this man's death because of their sins. And this young teenage boy had carried that weight around with him for over 2 years. The other day in the office, after everyone had left, Marty and I had a conversation about John Wesley, the founder of Methodism. And John Wesley had this radical belief that if you were not going to allow your heart to be changed by the gospel, then you were capable of doing more harm than good. That sounds very harsh, but as I think of this young man's journey and the lies that he believed and carried with him for so long because of religious people, I think when I envision that group in my mind, I think of a group that is capable of maybe doing more harm than good. I first sensed a calling on my life when I was around 14 or 15. And a short time after that, I began preaching in a bunch of local churches. And one church that I would fill in at on a regular occasion had a retired pastor in their parish by the name of Les Mullins. For any church, having a retired pastor is a blessing. And he, at that time, Les still served as a history teacher at Greenbrier West. So if I would preach a sermon at his church on Sunday or Wednesday evening, the following day I would go up to his classroom for lunch, and he would give me feedback on the pros and the cons and areas that I need to address. But he would always do so in a loving manner. I was always appreciative of Les, and I needed that, because after every sermon, it was just a group of older people that wanted to do their best to encourage me because I was someone considering going into ministry. They wanted to lift me up, and Les would always bring me back down to reality. And I am beyond thankful for that. One day at Greenbrier West, we had a social studies fair. I was delivering a presentation, and Les had retired by that time, but he had come back to serve as one of the panel of judges. And whenever the judges would ask me a question, I would always answer by saying, "I think," and then so on. Les pulled me to the side after my presentation, and he said, "Son, nobody cares what you think. Tell us what you know." It's no secret that in our world today, we have a lot of people telling us what they think. And if they don't know the answer to some question, they're never going to admit that. They are always going to go back to tell you what they think. Which is why it's important for us to memorize Scripture, to hear God's voice in our life, because if we don't know the truth, we can easily be persuaded by false teachings. If we don't know the truth, we can easily become false teachers ourselves, because we will say things that sound good to us that we would believe in, but are never found in Scripture. Commonly, whenever we go on a youth retreat, we offer a time of meditation for our students because we acknowledge that they have so many different voices in their heads between school and social media and their home lives that they just need to take a break for 5 to 10 minutes in the middle of all of that chaos and discover the voice of truth, to discover God's voice in this messy, confusing world. We have to set a time to hear from the voice of truth in order for us to share that truth. Towards the end of this scripture that Donna read for us today, I enjoy the way that Eugene Peterson phrases it in the Message translation. He said, "You're placed there as sentinels to truth. The message has to be preached all across the world." I like that, sentinels of truth. So our homework assignment for the day is this. Number one, tune into yourself. Before you can share your truth, you have to get really clear on what it is. Number two, set boundaries. A huge part of sharing your truth is learning how to lovingly communicate. Number three, use your voice. Ask God how you can use your voice for good. What positive message can you spread? What group can you speak up for? What positive change can you enact by speaking up? Let us pray. Lord, we know that you are the truth, and we need to hear from that because we have so many conflicting opinions in our heads. Help us to learn from your truth so that we can go on to share that truth with others. In Jesus' name, amen. Now we ask that you tune in and hear our prayer request.
Lisa Williams asks us to pray for the families of Patsy Sefrancis and Fenton Moore, who both passed away this past week and will be missed. Lara Edwards asks for prayers for a family member struggling with many serious issues going on in her life. Bobby Jackson asks for prayers for her friend, Linda. Linda Wheeler asks for prayers for a special family member. Lee Godby asks for prayers for Homer Hunter's gallbladder surgery and Perry McGraw, who has pneumonia. Becky Edwards asks for prayers for Roseanne Adams, who is recovering from surgery. Jim Bauer asks for continued prayers for Jane Spicer and prayers for Tina Tuckwiller. Diane Hayes shares a joy, gives special thanks to Harold Bland, Jack and Jessica Hicks, Diana Godby, Ann and Rick McClung, Susan Bossert, Al Koger, and Kevin Hayes for joining her yesterday in representing LUMC and distributing food to three senior living facilities from the Lewisburg Food Locker. We thank you all for representing the church and pray for you and thanksgiving for that. And we also lift up all of you who have unspoken prayer requests at home today.
That you speak truth over our hearts and our minds in a world that tells us untruths. We thank you, God, that your love is stronger than everything around us, so that when we become confused or feel like we've lost our way, your love speaks over our hearts and puts us on the right path. We ask, God, for all of these needs that we just shared with you. We lay them at your feet. We know there are things that have been spoken out loud, and there have been things that we have kept close within our own hearts. But you know them all. So we ask, God, that you will continue to do your work of grace in each of our life stories. All these things we ask in your precious Son, Jesus' name. Amen.
So our Jesus challenge for today is be on guard. And here is your homework assignment for this week. Tune into yourself, set boundaries, use your voice. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you. And
During this pandemic, so much of our world is closed down or shut down. Our church is still alive and vibrant. And even though we are not gathering physically, we have ministries that are still pouring out into this community. So we thank you for continuing to give financially through your offerings and your tithes. There's so much still to be done to reach this community, to be loving, to be kind to those around us, and to do the work of this church. So thank you for being a part of giving. If you would like to make a tithe or an offering or a gift, please do so in the following ways. You can mail it to P.O. Box 69. You can come by our breezeway or portico or in our church office and drop off a check. Or you can go to our website and give electronically. Thank you for your gracious giving.